It is time to delay the delay. All right, that is what we need to do right now, is to delay the delay. And I've been trying to figure out how to do that. How can I get the other channel started? I don't know yet. I've hit dead ends. I'm not quite able to figure it out, but delaying the delay, it turns out to be a great thing. Let's say there's somebody who is so despondent, they decide they're going to commit suicide, and they plan all it very carefully, and they get all the right pills, and they get everything ready. And on the time they decide this is it, they look for their pill, their stash, they hid away, and they can't find it. They can't find it. They say, oh no. And they say, maybe it's here. And they're tearing their room apart, tearing everywhere apart. They can't find the pills that they hid. And they're despondent. And they're so full of consternation and just all upset. And someone might see them. They say, hey, what's the matter? And they go, just feel terrible. They can't say, I misplaced the pills I was going to take. And they're really upset. So days go by, and they said, God, all that planning I did is wrong. God hates me. You can't even let me do myself in. How terrible. I'm just cursed, totally cursed, and just they get so upset. And then gradually someone says, hey, you know what? You're so upset, maybe you should have some therapy or you get some help. And so they do, and they get some help. And gradually they realize that somehow it turned out in their favor, that God was working for them by misplacing those pills. So we have a situation like that in the world, where the world is going to shift into high-speed pursuit of something. And those who do so think that they're making super-fast progress now. It's a great leap forward. But in fact, what really needs to happen is that the tires of the car need to be deflated. And so when they shift into high-speed pursuit, the car's on flat tires, and they go, wow, that's terrible. Look what happened. I can't do it. This is horrible. God has just cursed my life. This is awful. So let's back up a little bit and talk about the simple, simple truth. Literal truth is, what is existence? Existence is literally an imaginary self frantically pursuing nothing. And this imaginary self believes that when it finds nothing, it will make the imaginary self real. That meeting between nothing and an imaginary self will make the imaginary self real. That is literally what existence is. In its utmost simplicity, that is exactly what it is. Everything else is a little bit fuzzy, but that is exactly what's happening here. The I, whatever we think our identity, it's imaginary. It's an imaginary identity. And this imaginary identity is trying to find nothing. It's seeking high and low, trying to find nothing. So the world is about to shift into overdrive in its efforts to find nothing. It's going to go in high-speed pursuit of nothing. It's all ready to go. And as it shifts into high-speed pursuit of nothing, there's a lot of momentum in that. And that's called delay. It's an increase of delay. Everything, existence is just delay, because you can't find nothing. You cannot find it. And even if you did, this imaginary self doesn't mean anything. But there, you cannot find nothing. Absolutely cannot find nothing. It's impossible. So it's really just delay. All it is delay. But when you shift into overdrive, high-speed pursuit of nothing, you're wasting a lot of time. You're delaying. Severe delay. So God's plan of salvation is to, first and foremost, is to lessen the amount of delay. Really, ultimately, lessen the amount of delay that you engage in. So shifting into high-speed pursuit, going into overdrive, is very, very counter to God's plan of salvation. It's not something you want to do. If you are really keen on experiencing bliss, which is the alternative to searching, having an imaginary self searching for nothing, that's a hypothetical scenario. The alternative is another hypothetical scenario, which is reflecting reality, reflection of reality? What if reality couldn't be changed? What if reality just will always be what it is? That actually is a hypothetical, but it reflects reality. And the reflection of reality is what's called bliss. Like a mirror, accurately, a very perfectly accurate mirror reflecting reality. That's bliss, because reality would be called the big bliss. And we don't even need to call it anything, because our goal is to the reflection of reality is bliss. So that is, so either we experience bliss or we are searching for nothing. And not even we, an imaginary self, is searching for nothing. And it's all delay. So God doesn't want us to keep delaying, keep delaying, keep delaying. We're free. We have free will to do so. But the plan of salvation is to help us not keep engaging in these overdrive shifts into greater delay, greater search for nothing, better sophisticated technique. We have all this technology now. We got all this. We feel like we really can pin nothing down. We got the way to pin it down, and we're collectively together. We can do it. Yes, we can. Together, we can. We can do it. We can find nothing. Finally, so there's that feeling. We're finally gonna get it done. It's just delay. It's just delay. So, in that circumstance, you're in a car and it's on, you know, it's a muscle car. You're ready to go. You're ready to go. Just burn rubber, and you're gonna go for it. And you hit the accelerator, and it's flat tires. Flat tires. Jump out of the car and say, "That's terrible. Ah, I missed my opportunity. And my life is ruined. It's awful." And you'd be full of consternation. But after, and so then you have therapy, and you start talking to the therapist, and you sort it out and say, well, and gradually realize, oh, wait a minute, I was trying to search after nothing, and it wasn't even me, it was an imaginary self, and there's no necessity to it at all, and I can choose the alternative to choose bliss, and you start to see what it was all about. Then you say, oh my God, thank God I had flat tires. Thank God that I had flat tires. That's unbelievable grace. Ah, fantastic grace. But initially, there's consternation. There's consternation. And even anger towards God. Why could God do this? It's unbelievably terrible. So we're in a time now where it's very good to have flat tires. Very, very good. Very good to be tied up in some way you just can't get with this overdrive thing. Very, very helpful. So that's what I'm working on. How can we bring that about? Now, you know, a lot of people won't like it at first, really. Again, consternation. They think they missed their big opportunity. Their big opportunity. So there may be a period of consternation in the world. There may be something that just people just are all upset and just, And then at some point there has to be some therapy. There has to be some satsang. There has to be ways to help people gradually come out of that consternation. I feel like I've just, like my life, I feel like I missed the boat. I missed getting into that overdrive situation that's coming up. I fell through all the cracks, so I can't avail myself of it. And for a long time, I thought this is just, gosh, what a horrible life, what a terrible situation. But now I'm seeing, I'm very, very clear about bliss and how to be free, and it's all super clear. I realize, wow, I'm really having an incredibly great destiny. And so my life has been blessed, but I didn't see it that way. I sort of half and half. I said, maybe, but I don't know. This is also, it's terrible, because you feel like you want to do both. You want to cover both your bases. You want to have both hypotheticals. You want to find nothing and experience bliss. That's what we all want, right? We want the imaginary self to find nothing, and also we want to experience bliss. And you, of course, we can't do both of those, because you never can find nothing. And we have to exchange hypotheticals. So what are we going to do? What are we going to do is the question. How are we going to proceed in this world? It is coming up soon. There's no question about it. That something is really coming up, and I don't know if it's it may cause consternation. It may cause that because so many people are dead set on getting with this big push that's coming. A big push is coming. Big push in the world. It'll be like a quantum leap as far as the speed of pursuing nothing, the pursuit of nothing. And of course, in therapy, in satsang, you spiritual therapy, it will be explained how this came about in the first place, which I'm perfectly capable of doing. Perfectly capable of explaining the whole thing. The only thing that I lack is actually accepting bliss, and I'm not far away from that at all. I'm on the very verge of it, actually. It came about because spirit wanted to be prime creator, which would necessitate a change in reality, because spirit is not prime creator. And a change in reality, since reality is one indivisible whole, in other words, it can't be fragmented. You can't chip something off of reality. It's indivisible whole. If you changed any change of reality, it would mean you have to get rid of all of it, which would be the annihilation of reality, which would mean the annihilation of spirit too. So, and you're thinking about that, you said, wow, if I, in order to become crime creator, I got to find a way to survive this annihilation. Should this come about? It hasn't come about yet, but it might, if I can find a way to push this through. So how can I survive this? Spirit saying, show me a way to survive this. Well, mind says, well, if reality is destroyed, there'll be nothing there, right? I mean, nothing. Plus, you'll be destroyed too. So what we have to do is you have to say that you're now an imaginary self. You're not a real self, imaginary self. And that the way that you become real is that you find nothing. So that, in other words, nothing is somehow findable. Like, say, reality destroyed, there's nothing there, annihilated. Imagine that somehow nothing can be found. That is literally what this existence is. We are pursuing, trying to find nothing. And then we mind tells us, when we find nothing, that'll make us real. We will somehow be realized. We'll be real. Of course, it's complete madness, but it does symbolize our problem very well. It really does. So we are literally trying to find nothing. And we say, oh, we find nothing, we'll be enlightened, we'll be realized. The imaginary self will be realized at that point. Well, it may believe it's realized, but it's not. It doesn't have bliss. Imaginary self doesn't really have bliss, but you can, when you exchange hypothetical scenarios, bliss is simply there. Bliss is experiencing bliss, as it were. It's spirit that's aware of it. Spirit, it's like watching a movie. Spirit's like watching a movie of imaginary self searching for nothing. Then spirit can watch a movie of imaginary self experiencing bliss. Okay, that's possible. But there is no self other than spirit. Spirit, and spirit is one with reality. Reality is the self. So in a hypothetical, you the best you have is a reflection of reality. So you'd have a reflected self experiencing reflection of reality, which would be bliss. You certainly don't want to keep on searching for nothing. That is for sure. So, deflation is very good. Deflation of the tires is good. How do we deflate the tires is the question. That's what I'm working on. I've always been trying to find out. There must be some way to throw a monkey wrench into everything and deflate the tires of as many that want to have their tires deflated so that they don't go with the crowd, go with the herd into this increased effort to find nothing, which is just a disaster. It's a disaster. The world's really heading for disaster. But some people would think that the flat tires are a disaster. That's a beautiful disaster. That's the kind of disaster you want, really. How many times have you had something in your life that, this is terrible, something happened, then later you find out that it saved you from something worse? Happens all the time, really. That's grace at work. Saying, look, sure you don't want flat tires, but because you had flat tires, you were able to miss the boat, and the boat sank. You see, you're trying to get to the boat before it leaves, and you have flat tires, you can't get there, and you miss the boat, and then you're so upset, you missed the cruise of a lifetime, you missed it. And you're just saying, my life is just terrible. God hates me, I have no grace, it's ridiculous. And then later on, you read in the paper, or something, you find out that the cruise ship hit an iceberg and it sank and everyone was lost. And you say, oh my gosh. It's like that. So, how do we do that? I don't know. There's some ideas, some possibilities, but it's. But God will find a way. God will find a way. Blessed are the poor in spirit, they shall inherit the kingdom. Meaning, blessed are those who have flat tires at this time. Because they will then basically have no choice but to look at bliss and say, wow, I'm not going to be able to find nothing, so but what else, what's my option? And then someone will come along and say, hey, bliss is your option. Really important. Bliss is super important right now. Super important. That is, for 2013 is the year of bliss. Has to be. That's the only other option there is, because exchanging hypotheticals. One, the hypothetical that what if reality could be destroyed or changed and destroyed, or the other is what if reality could not be destroyed. Those are the only two hypotheticals there really are. I mean, you're either in a entertaining a hypothetical or you're in reality. There's no other option, none, because all to not be aware of reality is a hypothetical, because you're in reality. So you have to say, well, hypothetically, what if I were not in reality? That's the only option there is. If you don't want to experience reality, you have to entertain a hypothetical. There is no other option. So either you have the hypothetical, reality can be changed, or you have the hypothetical, it can't be changed. And the hypothetical that it can't be changed is bliss. That's the only effect there is. The only effect there is, because there's no, it's just reflecting reality. Like it's like a perfect mirror. A mirror is not producing its own effects. It's just reflecting. That's what bliss does. That's what this hypothetical does. It just says, what if reality were exactly as it is? So there's no, bliss is perfect from the very beginning. It's always been perfect. It's totally stable. It's totally steady. It's totally unconditional. It doesn't change. It doesn't add to itself. It just is what it is and remains as it is. And so that is, bliss is the answer for us. It really is the answer. It's the stability we've been looking for. It's the peace. It's the love. It's the clarity. It's everything that we need to then enable us to be translated back to reality, to say, you know what? I don't even need the reflection anymore, because I'm so used to the beauty of reality. I can set the mirror down. It's like we're looking in the mirror at ourselves, and finally we can just be who we are, as it were. You've seen something in a mirror, like something beautiful, and then you finally turn around and look and see what it is that you've been seeing in the mirror. But first you see it in the mirror, because we're so used to hypothetical that we want to feel that there's something hypothetical there. Well, what if? What if reality could be perfectly reflected? What if reality could not change? So that's our option. Either that or you have an imaginary self trying to complete itself by finding nothing, trying to become real by finding nothing. Those are the only two options you have. Either you are watching this movie of an imaginary self trying to become real by finding nothing, or you experience bliss. That is it. We have two options and two options only. Of course, you never left reality at all. So the option of going back to reality, you're actually already there. It's just how you remember that you're already there. And you have these, you either forget or you remember. You either continue forgetting that you're never left reality, or you remember you never left reality. Those are the only two options we have. And so again, one is like watching a movie of an imaginary self trying to become real by finding nothing. And the other is bliss. So It's super important to focus on bliss. Super important. When you see, we've already boiled it down, 2013, it's boiled down to bliss. Boiling it all down to bliss. That's what's happened. And I'm not really sure how to proceed. That's why I'm struggling, really struggling to, so I just don't know exactly what to do. It's a new game. The cycle ended 12/21/12. The cycle ended. It's a new age now. We're in a new age. And this is the new age means there's going to be this shift into overdrive. High speed pursuit of nothing. The imaginary self is saying, you know what? It's time to complete, become real. And I know I'm going to do it now. I'm going to find nothing and become real. And it's going to really shift into overdrive. That's the new age. So I'm not really sure how to function in this new age at this point right now. I'm not really, but because it has to be bliss. It has to be bliss. Bliss has to come to the front somehow. And so far, I'm not really sure how that's going to happen. I'm exploring all sorts of avenues and trying to get clear on it. And all sorts of stuff is percolating and bubbling, but not quite sure how to proceed. So it's a stressful time. Have to come up with something soon, because the overdrive is coming. It's coming after inauguration time. It is coming, and that's what it's all about. Is say, hey everybody, it's time to go. It's time to shift into overdrive. And the whole world's going to shift into overdrive, big time. And they say, yeah, we're about ready to pounce on nothing. We've got it in our sights. We've got the technology now to find it. How can you find nothing? I say, how can you find nothing? Cannot. It's a completely ridiculous whim from the very beginning, isn't it? Go out in search of nothing? Total whim. But it's a total whim to try and become prime creator too, isn't it? The origin of it, the choosing that idea. Spirit saying, I want to be prime creator. It's a total whim. No possibility of that ever happening. So have been entertaining a whim, trying to find nothing, in mad pursuit of nothing, and we don't realize it. And we're about to accelerate it. We don't want to accelerate it. What I had in a dream, I was starting to accelerate, riding a bike, and suddenly I said, whoa, I forgot something back there. I'd forgotten something that was really important to me. And I turned around and went back and got what was important to me. And I said, is that really that important? I said, well, I don't know. But then something else, I came across bliss somehow. Reconnected with bliss. So I didn't go through the acceleration, and I was able to, what happened, I forgot something. And that was my flat tires. My flat tire was that I'd forgotten something. I needed to go back and remember what it was that I'd forgotten. I left something behind. But the others were accelerating. They were really accelerating. And I said, well, that's okay. I'm not really missing out on anything. Because if you're aware of bliss, you know that's what you really are after. You're not after nothing. You're after bliss. So how can you feel you're missing out on something if you're right on the verge of experiencing bliss, which is what I am, where I am. So I don't feel like I'm going to be missing anything by chasing after nothing, trying to find nothing, because I have in my sights, I have what I want. I've been looking at bliss and defining it and seeing what it must be through reason is showing me this is what it must be like, and getting kind of a mental picture of it, and then feeling this presence is very, very close right now to me, very close. Can almost put my mind into that. So I don't feel like I'm going to be missing anything at all by not going along with the big shift, big shift that's coming up. The big boost is to miss the big shift, really. It's to have your tires flattened. Maybe called the big blowout. Have a blowout in your tire and say, I can't do it. Can't do it. I missed it. Doggone it. And you say, later on you say, oh, that's best thing that ever happened to me. Saved me thousands and thousands and thousands of years. An unbelievable amount of misery and suffering. So how to present this is something I'm not sure. I really don't know. I really don't know. I'm trying all sorts of stuff. It's just not going. It's so hard to do anything multimedia because the copyright issue. I hate the copyright issue. It's so terrible. I don't want to just grab people's works and do a mashup, and you know, I could cobble together stuff and be pretty doggone good what I could do, but it's copyrighted, or they, you know, it's not released to Creative Commons, and then I feel like I get real nervous because I don't want to do that to people. I don't want to kind of strong arm them that way without permission. That's really not what I do. So I'm kind of, my hands are tied. I don't know what else to do. We need some new approach, okay? What I'm saying is we need a new approach at this time. We need a new approach. This approach here has been very beneficial, but it doesn't quite seem like it has the juice now that it did before for me. What I feel is like a new approach is needed. Some type of new approach is needed. So I'm searching for that new approach. A new format. It's a new age. 2013. It's a whole new ball game. Really, it is. It really is. It's so. Times change. You have to change with the times. You have to change your approach with the times. And I'm not quite sure what it is. I'm entertaining all sorts of ideas. All sorts of ideas. What can be done? Just a brainstorm. In other words, just to find out. Meanwhile, I'm not losing momentum. Really. It's momentum continues. So just seeing very clearly that we are simply, this existence is just imaginary self trying to find nothing. That's literally it. And of course some say they have found nothing, right? The imaginary self found nothing, and it found imaginary enlightenment too. Forget about enlightenment, okay? Forget about it. Forget about realization. Forget about all that stuff. Focus on bliss. Focus on bliss. That is the true condition of exchanging hypotheticals. That is the truth, the plan, salvation, the plan of God. That is the true condition, is bliss. And how many people, how many of you have seen that are truly in bliss? See, that's rare. That is rare. When you find someone who's truly in bliss, pay attention to that. Pay attention. Very stable. Bliss is entirely stable, and of course the world is so unstable. It seems superficially it might not seem stable, but you can tell if there's bliss there. It really is just unbelievably stable, unbelievably unconcerned, unbelievably, we can use words like confident, self-assured, no chance of failure, never known failure. Bliss has never known any failure. It's never failed to be what it is. It's never tried to be other than what it is. So there's no failure. No failure. Perfect confidence. Perfect assurance just in itself. It's just a quality you don't find in this world. In the world of an imaginary self trying to find nothing. You don't find that quality. You do not. So it's a quality that you haven't come across before. And when you come across it, you know it. You say, well, this is a different thing altogether. And they say, what is that? It's bliss. It's bliss. It's not ecstasy, like some kind of emotional ecstasy or something. No. Way, way deeper, more stable than anything like that. You can't get it from any drug experience. You're like, no. That's totally superficial. Bliss is completely profound, complete depth, complete stability, and just a sacredness beyond description, really. If I'm trying to just sort of peek into it, as it were. And a wholeness, a sacredness, a profundity, a peace, a calm, a stability, and a sweetness, and a gentleness, and a love, loveliness, and a beauty, and all of that, completely stable. All of it together, stable, entire package of that, all stable and smooth and seamless. And you cannot lose it. There's nowhere for it to go. It's everywhere. It can't be lost unto itself. cannot, because it's not trying to say that reality could be annihilated, you see? So, bliss, 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 2013, a year of bliss. Focus on bliss, focus on that, have to focus, and there has to be some way to do that. And so our goal, our task, our challenge is to find the way to do that now. And I'm stressed out trying to find a way, really. All the stuff that I'm trying, it's just coming up short. So anyway, where there's God's grace, there's a way to do it. And I came up with this way to get us to this point, to 2013, to get us primed for 2013, so that we will focus on bliss and not focus on shifting in the overdrive of, that the world is going to shift into. The world doesn't have bliss as its goal. Its goal is to have something greater than even the great bliss of reality. Its goal is to make an unreal self real. That is the goal of reality, which is a completely impossible, ludicrous, crazy, insane, ridiculous, whimsical idea. To make what is unreal real. To make an imaginary self real. But what is real is what is created by God. So, of course, it's made real by what? Nothing, which is, again, totally crazy. It's just totally crazy what existence is about. And also completely unnecessary. We don't need this contingency plan, because reality will never be changed. No need, never any need for this contingency plan. So, we don't need to spend any more time trying to make the unreal real. So our focus, bliss. And how we do that, I have to find out. And I'm really praying on it and meditating and focusing and brainstorming. And so I'm not slacking at all. And I just have not come up with the right mix. I don't know if I'm going to try some stuff. You know, if I try some stuff, it may not, maybe clumsy and awkward and not quite it at first. But maybe I just have to try something. I don't know. You have to put up with it if you want to. But keep in mind what I'm saying about the future here is that the shift into overdrive to searching for nothing, or you can turn to bliss. Those are your two options. You don't have any other option. The ego keeps telling you have another option. It's deluding you. It's tricking you. You don't listen to the ego. You don't have any other option. You're either pursuing nothing, trying to make the unreal self real, or you're experiencing bliss. There is no other option whatsoever. The only difference where the ego tricks you is the speed of pursuit, or how you're pursuing. And it changes speeds and shifts, like gear shifts, and then it tries to tell you you're doing something different. You're not doing anything different. It's like driving a car in first gear, and then you put it into second, and then third, and fourth, then downshift back to first, and then put it in reverse. You're going on. You're still in the car, driving the car along the road. You're not doing anything different. The speed is different. Well, if you put it in reverse, maybe that's a different story. But as you're going forward, it's just the speed, and maybe the road goes this way and that way and that way. And you think, hey, I just shifted. This is a whole new thing. I just shifted in an overdrive. You hit the overdrive button. Wow, we're doing something totally different now. This is great. I'm free. No, you're just pursuing nothing in a more intense, quick manner, so to speak, which is meaningless because there's nothing there to pursue. You're just going around in circles a little faster or something, you know, wandering aimlessly around some way, a little faster, more intensely or whatever. So, in a more coordinated way, all meaningless. It's not something different. Doing exactly the same. Still the same hypothetical. Nothing has changed. But the illusion of change in this hypothetical is constant. There's constantly an illusion of change. But nothing is changing. Same hypothetical. The change we need to make is exchanging hypotheticals. The cross is a symbol of exchanging hypotheticals. You have the horizontal, which is just to continue on searching for nothing, and then the vertical of the cross, like this, is reflection of reality, which bliss, which leads back to reality. See, it's a different hypothetical. You have two hypotheticals. You have the horizontal, which is flat, it just keeps going on searching for nothing, and then the vertical part of the cross is the other hypothetical. What if reality could not be changed? And that gives you first bliss, and then reality translates back to reality. That's the symbolism of the cross, the Christian cross, as far as I see it. The spiritual symbolism is the two hypotheticals. Which one are you going to choose? The two hypotheticals. One or the other, one or the other, one or the other. Now, of course, crucifixion is when you're trying to please both, trying to nail yourself to both. That's the crucified Christ, Jesus on the cross is when we try to please both. Try to say, no, I'm going to have both hypotheticals. You cannot. That ends up with depression. It ends up with suicide and depression. We're trying to do that. You feel that you're not going anywhere at all. You have nothing. You feel like you're nothing, having nothing, and never have. It's a horrible thing. Horrible thing. It's like you say, well, or you try to say, well, I don't have either reality or a hypothetical. I've got something else. And then you feel like you're crucified, and you can't choose either one. And we've covered that many times in other videos. So you don't want to be crucified on trying to sit on the fence and say, no, I can believe that reality can be changed, and I can believe that it can't be changed. I can have those both simultaneously. I have them both. I'll embrace both of them. When you embrace both of them, you will find yourself in a state of absolute chaos, which is the crucifixion. Torture, mental torture. Mental torture, mental death almost, as it were, really. And I've been there. I know exactly what that's about. Being crucified on that cross of trying to embrace both of those. The reality can be changed, and reality cannot be changed. Two hypotheticals and trying to put them in, have them both be one. Not possible. You know, chaos ensues in your mind. Chaos is horrible. So get off that cross. Be resurrected. Choose one. Choose the hypothetical reality cannot be changed, and that results in bliss. And that is the rebirth, the spiritual rebirth, the birth of Christ within you, the birth of the spiritual rebirth. For now, as you say, it's Christ that lives within me, meaning it's bliss that lives within me. Reflection of reality lives within me, and the mad pursuit of nothing is no more. You're not in any pursuit of anything. You have the bliss. It's with you all the time. There's nowhere you can't lose it. Can't go anywhere. It's a different hypothetical, and so everything is perfect. Everything is beautiful. And can't be affected. The world doesn't affect it. Doesn't affect it. It's like an overlay. It's not affected by what it overlays. It's not affected by it in any way. So we don't want to be crucified on the cross of trying to embrace. We don't want to go embrace the horizontal one of trying to pursue nothing. We don't want to. Those two options are terrible. The third option would be to exchange hypothetical scenarios. And choose the one of not, that reality cannot be changed in any way, can't be changed. What if reality couldn't be changed? And that's bliss. You experience bliss. The effect of that is bliss. That's it. No more effects. Not 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 effects. It's not bliss for a while, then it changes into something else. Or bliss is not something else came before bliss. No, that hypothetical was bliss from the very beginning, and it's bliss to the always with that hypothetical. Always it is simply bliss. That's it. Nothing else. You don't need to say, okay, I've got bliss, I'm going to find something else. And the bliss is it's equal bliss. It's not like something special, like I have a special bliss and that others cannot have. It's just bliss. That's it. It's a reflection of reality. So you can't say, well, I have higher bliss than you do, or something like that. No, it's all the same. It's all the same bliss. They're not levels of in bliss. There's no levels to bliss. None whatsoever. So you can't. Yeah, when you have bliss, you can't say, "Well, I'm up here. I have the great. I have this superior bliss, and everyone else who has the bliss, well, they're down here. They have less." No. It's not that way at all. It's just bliss. It's just a perfect mirror reflecting reality. Now, people may differ in how accustomed they are to it, and how they start to relate back to reality and get ready for that. But the bliss is the same. The bliss is the same. There's not somebody that found a better bliss, okay, and says, "I got the highest bliss. I'm level 7. I got the highest bliss now, and nobody else can get it because I found it first, and it's mine." Everybody else, you got to settle for lesser bliss. Level 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, you know, you can't have this. It's the highest bliss. I got it. Not like that at all. No. Everybody that exchanges hypothetical gets the same bliss. It's the same bliss always. Just one effect. It's the same bliss that everyone gets. So we might be worried about what else? Maybe someone else has a higher bliss and they're going to enslave me. And no, not true at all. People who talk like that are talking about a fake bliss, not the true stuff at all. The true bliss is unconditional. Equal, gives equally to everything. Equal to everything, absolutely equal. All that enter into the same bliss, the same equal distribution, absolutely. So we can overcome the obstacles to it. There have been obstacles set on our path. We have to move them out of the way. And widen the channel out, open as it were, and get that experience. Abide in the bliss, as Ramana said, abide in the self, abide in the bliss. The bliss is our quote-unquote self. It's a reflection of reality, but it's all we need to get in order to then have ultimately set that hypothetical down too, and easily translated back to reality, easily, no problem whatsoever. So that is what we want. Abide in the self, abide in the bliss. And by making it our purpose, making it our focus, we start asking about bliss, thinking about it. Say, what is it like? And we start to get a clearer picture, and the fog starts to dissipate. And then we say, hey, you know what? Yeah, I can do that. I'm going to do that. So here we go, and we'll have to see how it formats. How does bliss format? I'm just saying, pray to bliss. How do you want this to all take place now? Because it has to take place now. It's got to. Time is now for sure. Before the overdrive, world shifts into overdrive. Okay, very great. Whew, that's it. Get in from this cold. And I don't know about tomorrow. It's going to be supposed to be really, really cold. But we'll see. Come on, spring, hurry up, get here. Can't wait.